Hey everyone, this lesson is on the fungal skin infection known as jock itch. In this lesson, we're going to talk about what this condition is. We're also going to talk about what causes it, some of the risk factors for this condition. We're also going to talk about some of the signs and symptoms, how we can diagnose it, and how we can treat it. So jock itch is also known as Tinea Cruris. So here's an image of jock itch. And it is a superficial skin infection of the groin area, of the crural fold. That's where that name comes from. Caused by fungi known as dermatophytes. And this condition may be confused with another type of fungal skin infection known as intertrigo, which is caused by Candida, which is a yeast. So jock itch is more likely to occur in males much more frequently than it is in females. And some of the causative organisms of jock itch include the following. Number one is trichophyton rubrum. The dermatophyte trichophyton rubrum is actually the most common causative organism of jock itch. Another one that we may see is something called trichophyton interdigitale, and we may also see epidermophyton phlocosum. So how is Tinea cruris transmitted? Oftentimes it is actually spread from another fungal infection location, mostly from Tinea pedis or athlete's foot, so you can get autoinfection. What that means is that an individual who has athlete's foot can spread the fungi from their feet into the groin area, causing Tinea cruris. And it can also be transmitted from other humans, animals, and even soil. What are some of the factors that increase your risk for getting this condition? The number one risk factor for getting Tinea cruris or jock itch is excessive sweating. We can also see it being associated with physical activities that cause excessive sweating. So related to the excessive sweating, physical activities that cause excessive sweating, particularly in the groin area, can increase your risk for getting this condition. Being male or being of the male gender is also a risk factor. So we talked about this before. Males are far more likely to have this condition than females. Being obese or overweight can increase your risk for getting this condition. Being diabetic, so having a systemic issue that causes some immunocompromise, can increase your risk for this condition. And again, immunosuppression, so it could be due to medications or it could be due to a systemic illness causing immunosuppression. Tight-fitted clothing can also increase your risk for this condition as well. Poor hygiene in the area. So if you don't wash and dry properly, you can have an increased risk for getting this condition. Contact sport athletes are at a higher risk for this condition as well. And there's also this genetic predisposition to having fungal infections in general. So if for some reason you have decreased beta defenses, like defensin beta 4, you're at an increased risk for getting tinea infections in general, and one of those is jock itch or Tinea cruris. So what does it actually look like? So here is Tinea cruris. So Tinea cruris often starts as an erythematous area in the medial thigh. So medial thigh is the inner thigh. And it is pruritic, which means that it is itchy. So that's where the name comes from, jock itch. And it is erythematous, which means that it's reddened in color. And it could be a patch, so if you were to feel it, it might be flat, or it could be slightly elevated to be a plaque. And what we do find is that when it starts to extend outward with a centrifugal spread. So it spreads out. And the outer edge of this lesion might have small little vesicles on it. And this lesion can spread into other areas of the groin, including the perineum and the gluteal cleft. And in males, what is interesting is that the scrotum is often spared in Tinea cruris. This is going to help us distinguish it from another common fungal skin infection, because we find that candidal intertrigo affects the scrotum, whereas Tinea cruris does not. So when we look at the skin lesion itself, we see that it is a clearly demarcated border, which means that the difference between the lesion and the normal skin around it is a very clear, distinct separation. And there may be a slightly raised edge to it with those small vesicles in some cases. So again, Tinea cruris or jock itch starts as a reddened and itchy skin lesion in the medial thigh or the inner thigh. And it actually spreads outward from that location, outward centrifugally, and it has a very well demarcated border, as you can see here, and sometimes has small vesicles at the outer edge of that border. It can then spread into other areas of the groin, including the perineum and gluteal cleft, but in males, it spares the scrotum, as opposed to intertrigo or intertrigo, which affects the scrotum. So those are key characteristics of Tinea cruris. So I want to quickly talk about candidal intertrigo or candidal intertrigo, because this condition can often be confused with jock itch or Tinea cruris. So candidal intertrigo occurs in the area where skin rubs on skin. So the intertriginous areas. So that's what that means, where skin rubs on skin. So it can affect areas like the groin, the axilla, so under the armpits, the pannus. So pannus could be where an individual has a very large abdomen and the under part of the abdomen is rubbing on another part of the skin that can cause or increase your risk for getting this infection. And inframammary, which is under the breasts. All of these areas can be affected by candidal intertrigo. So because candidal intertrigo can affect the groin, it can be confused with Tinea cruris. So what are some ways that we can distinguish these two infections? So for one, candidal intertrigo affects areas where skin rubs on skin. That might not help out with jock itch when we're trying to distinguish this. But what's important here is that in males, intertrigo can affect the scrotum, whereas with jock itch or Tinea cruris, the scrotum is not affected. So that's another way we can distinguish these two. And the look of candidal intertrigo looks a bit different as well. Oftentimes it's moist, it's reddened area, there's some skin breakdown. There may even be some discharge from the site. So it looks just it looks a little bit wet as opposed to Tinea cruris, which is often more dry. And the patient describes burning and they may also have some itching sensation there as well. And what's important with regards to both treating and preventing candidal intertrigo is that cleaning and keeping the area dry are key factors to preventing this condition in the first place. So again, intertrigo may be confused with Tinea cruris or jock itch, but there's a couple ways we can distinguish the two. Intertrigo occurs where skin rubs on skin, and the scrotum is often affected in males, whereas in Tinea cruris or jock itch, the scrotum is not affected. In Tinea cruris, we see centrifugal spread, whereas in candidal intertrigo or intertrigo, we don't see that centrifugal spread. We see it where the skin rubs on the skin. And in intertrigo, we see skin breakdown and sometimes see discharge or a moist look to the skin, which is different than in Tinea cruris. So how do we diagnose and treat Tinea cruris? So diagnosis of Tinea cruris or jock itch is often a clinical one. We look at the skin lesion and we look at their risk factors and we determine that this is Tinea cruris or jock itch. We always have to think, is this intertrigo? So again, look at those ways that we distinguished the two before. We could do a KOH wet mount, looking at skin scraping. So you take the skin scrapings, you use KOH, and then you visualize segmented hyphae. And this tells us that it is a fungal skin infection. The treatment of Tinea cruris involves modifying risk factors. That's the big thing here. We want to avoid getting Tinea cruris later on in the future. So we want to try to keep the area dry. You can use powders to do this, and you want to avoid hot baths. And as I mentioned before, a lot of times this is an autoinfection. So an individual who has Tinea pedis can actually spread the fungi from their feet into the groin area. So you want to treat concomitant Tinea pedis and even treat concomitant onychomycosis or a fungal nail infection. And the way we actually do treat Tinea cruris or jock itch is using topical antifungals. And importantly, the way we treat intertrigo is using topical antifungals as well. So even if you make a mistake, you can still use topical antifungals to treat both of these conditions. And the topical antifungals are the azoles, naphthaphene, butenaphene, and polnaphtate. And oftentimes this may take up to 3 to 4 weeks for effective treatment. And again, nystatin is not effective in these cases. Nystatin does not treat dermatophyte infections. And if the topical antifungals don't work, we can move on to oral antifungals. So we can use terbinafine and itraconazole orally. So again, diagnosis is clinical. So we look at the skin lesion and we look at the risk factors and we make the diagnosis that way, or we could do a KOH wet mound. Modify the risk factors. So important to modify risk factors, keep the area dry, avoid some of those risk factors we talked about before, control your blood sugars if you have diabetes. And important here is to treat concomitant co-occurring Tinea pedis infections. Topical antifungals are the first line. Again, nystatin is not effective. And then oral antifungals if the topicals are not effective. For For more information on fungal skin infections, please check out my overview to fungal skin infections and my lessons on athlete's foot and ringworm. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up and consider subscribing. And as always, continue to live, laugh, and learn, and I hope to see you next time.